This is a $2,000 NVIDIA RTX 5090. Is it possible for a $2,000 graphics card to actually be worth it? So, I was actually not going to make this video, but when I was at CES, I went to the NVIDIA press conference, and that keynote was unbelievable. I've been to a lot of CESs, and the fact that NVIDIA had an entire basketball venue filled to capacity with another 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 people outside in line who couldn't get inside, just to see Jensen unveil a brand new graphics card and some other stuff. But this is not normal. Now, if you've been paying attention to tech over the last year or so, you'll know that NVIDIA has become the world's most valuable company, largely off the back of some incredible hype around AI. And it's deserved. NVIDIA has spent a lot of years putting down a lot of smart bets, and they have absolutely paid off. But is it a smart bet for you to wager $2,000 of your own money on a brand new graphics card? Yeah, there's a lot to talk about here.
I need you to catch this box. Like, really, really, I need you to catch this box.
Originally, I was going to cover the 5090 in mystery tech. In fact, so much so that I did an entire unboxing section showing off the card.
Inspired by gamers, enhanced by AI.
Oh God.
We got a Switch 2, baby!
Woo! Something tells me that's not true. Wait, does it keep going?
Yes.
Built by NVIDIA.
We got a Switch 3, baby!
This was a review sample, right? Of some NVIDIA thing that's probably really expensive?
No, we found a guy who
No!
Is also
Alex,
the guy.
Where did this come from?
NVIDIA.
Okay, cool.
It's also from the guy that got us the
No! Early. Censor all that, censor all of that. Alright. Behold my friends.
Well, that's not gonna fit in a case.
RTX 5090. So you see the whole thing? It's just like a big old cardboard box. And then we've got like power cables and stuff here. Okay, revealing in 3, 2, 1. Wow!
That is not that much smaller.
This is the RTX 5090. This bad boy is literally the most powerful GPU that you could possibly get your hands on, theoretically. And
you can't say literally and then say theoretically.
No, okay.
That the two are mutually exclusive.
This is the fastest consumer graphics card that anyone could buy for gaming.
Exactly. I'm recording this before anyone has actually properly tested this card. But theoretically, it is going to be incredibly powerful and incredibly expensive because the RTX 5090 retails for $2,000. Yup. That's what we in the biz call a lot of money. Oh my God, is that 4 8-pins? What? 4 8-pins? This is like the power for a nuclear reactor. What the hell, man?
It's all gone, part five.
I'm going to take this home, thoroughly evaluate it.
Not just yet. Yeah.
For a really, really good graphics card, you need a really, really cool thing that's in this box.
Hey, little buddy, I haven't seen you in a while. You wanna help me unbox something?
Hey, look on the side. There's a little hint.
Is this a Roboraptor PC case?
Wow.
You see this?
Oh.
Oh my. Are we really gonna put an RTX 5090 in a Roboraptor
case?
Yes,
it's only fitting.
Oh my God, it's literally blue.
So, it matches
the- It matches! He recognizes him!
Stay tuned, my friends. Roboraptor RTX 5090 PC coming soon.
Looking at the 5090, it is clear that this is an expensive piece of hardware. Unlike traditional graphics cards, which are, I'll say, a little bit more straightforward in their design, this actually has flow through on both front and back. So if you look on the inside, it actually has all of the actual GPU bits on the middle. So the power delivery, the actual GPU itself, the memory, and it actually has a little daughter board for none of the PCI slots, but also the rear IO, largely because they wanted to absolutely cram as much power and as relatively small package as possible. But we're talking $2,000 for a graphics card. Like, is that ever actually worth it? As you might expect from the guys who are building their RTX 5090 test bench in a literal Roboraptor case, we're not going to be the most thorough review. I'm sure there's lots of other people who are going live at the exact same time who will give you 30 different GPU benchmarks across all these kinds of systems. But the main thing I want to do is find out just what the 5090 actually gives you for $2,000. And if I have some help from my buddy Roboraptor along the way, it's not gonna be a bad thing. Even though this was originally just going to be a mystery tech segment, I'm actually glad that we're doing it inside this test bench, because even though the RTX 5090 is a relatively like decent sized card, it's not like absolutely massive, but the problem is that trying to push 575 watts with a GPU in a small case is just a recipe for making a toaster oven. So the fact that this is an open air test bench should mean that we'll get pretty reasonable thermals, because man, 575 watts plus another 100, 200 watts for your CPU and everything else, you're gonna be absolutely cooking a lot of regular cases. So let's finish building this thing and see what our 5090 can actually do. Look, if you're the kind of person who just wants the best of the best, then I'll make it easy for you. Go buy a 5090 and call it a day. But there is a lot more to this card and this launch that I think is worth talking about, even if you don't have $2,000 plus burning a hole in your pocket. Because let's be real here, you can't talk about this card without addressing the elephant or the dinosaur in the room, AI. It is the buzzword of 2025, and NVIDIA and their stock absolutely knows it. The marketing material for the 5090 is absolutely packed with AI features and improvements outside of the raw horsepower of the graphics card. But instead of getting lost in all of the hype, let's focus on what's actually new and different here. Like my line about the dinosaurs? Let's not let the dinosaur in the room, haha. Get it? As this is Roboraptor jokes. DLSS, or Deep Learning Supersampling, has become a bit of a catch-all term at this point. It started as pure upscaling technology, but it now covers everything from improving image quality to generating entirely new frames. To be honest, there are so many versions and modes of DLSS that it can be overwhelming even for a hardcore gamer, especially since each game varies in supporting maybe one or two or even all of these features. So let's break it down bit by bit. First up is what you might call classic DLSS, super resolution. The basic concept hasn't really changed. The GPU renders a lower resolution image and then uses specialized tensor cores to upscale it to your target resolution. What is new with DLSS 4 is how it handles this upscaling. The RTX 50 series uses what NVIDIA calls a transformer-based AI model, which is theoretically similar to what powers AI tools such as ChatGPT. This is significantly smarter in understanding the entire frame as opposed to small parts of it. In theory, this means better temporal stability, aka less flickering and artifacts when things are moving, and particularly big improvements when it comes to ray traced content. Now, NVIDIA claims that it is especially noticeable on those traditionally tough details like chain link fences and power lines, where older DLSS versions could sometimes struggle. So for this testing, we've used Cyberpunk 2077, which is one of the Halo games for the launch. It supports basically all of the DLSS bells and whistles, and by default, with everything cranked up at 4K without running DLSS, you're getting about 32 FPS on the 5090. By adding super resolution set to ultra performance without frame generation, that turns in to 126 FPS, which I probably don't need to tell you is a massive improvement. Now, image quality isn't perfect, as we'll discuss in a second, but this is only one half of the story. Potentially the most interesting new feature is DLSS frame generation. The previous version on 40 series cards could generate one extra frame between each real frame to boost performance and really the perceived fluidity. Cool concept, but it wasn't perfect. You'd sometimes notice stuttering or inconsistent frame pacing that could make games feel less smooth than if you had the extra real frames. Now, with DLSS 4, you can do multi-frame generation. Instead of just generating one extra frame, you can generate up to three additional frames for every real frame that the GPU renders. This might sound complicated, but when you pair it with super resolution, the image quality is still largely impressive, although if you do look closely at some motion like this NPC, which looks warped and terrible, you have to kind of take it in moderation. Setting the super resolution mode to performance or even quality largely cleans this up while still giving you a very substantial performance boost. On paper, this sounds amazing, but you might be wondering, why does this matter if it doesn't improve or potentially even makes it worse when it comes to the input latency side of things? Well, remember that the FPS count isn't everything when you're adding extra fake frames, because while yes, the game may look smoother,
that's not necessarily going to be any more responsive? The answer is some secret sauce that is built into the RTX 50 series. NVIDIA has tweaked the AI model to run faster, it uses less RAM, and it relies on the GPU instead of the CPU to handle your frame pacing. In theory, this should mean that you've got much smoother gameplay, even with all these additional AI-generated frames. Now, when you look at the benchmarks, the frame jump is absolutely huge. We're going up to 288 FPS in performance mode, or an absurd 370 FPS with the full 4x frame generation, as well as turning upscaling to full ultra performance. Now, it's not as responsive as a real 370 FPS game, but the fact that by flipping these settings on brings us from 32 to 370 frames per second is absolutely wild. Now, I want to be really clear, turning everything to the max is a little bit much and you really shouldn't do that, but in moderation, what NVIDIA are doing here, it sort of makes you think about what the performance of a game actually means. Of course, all of this impressive tech comes at a cost. The 5090 will absolutely hit its rated 575 watt power limit under full load. And since we're still on the exact same TSMC 4 nanometer process that they used to make the 40 series, there's no free lunch here. More performance means more power draw, even with all of these architectural improvements. Now, at least NVIDIA is putting all of that power to good use. The 5090 is the first graphics card to ship with GDDR7 memory, delivering roughly 30% more bandwidth than the 4090. It's clear that NVIDIA went through a lot of expensive engineering to maximize cooling to a degree that I have never seen before in a graphics card. But here's the thing though. The only real competition for the RTX 5090 is NVIDIA themselves. Now, the 4090 has been the undisputed performance king ever since it launched back in 2022. And now, the world's most valuable company is, well, they're essentially trying to top their own high score. And let's not forget that back in 2022, the 4090 retail price was $1,600. And then the card sold out everywhere, and immediately the street pricing jumped all the way up to $1,800 to $2,000 or even more. And then that just kind of became normal. So much so that when NVIDIA announced the $2,000 price tag for the 5090, it was met with a general meh, even though it amounts to a $400 price hike. Business as usual, right? Now, it shouldn't be surprising that this is the most powerful and technically impressive graphics card that we have ever seen. It also shouldn't be that surprising that for 95% of people, you're better off waiting for this technology to trickle down to more reasonable RTX 50 series cards like a theoretical 5060. Now, the transformer-based DLSS improvements, as well as the better frame generation, they will eventually make their way to cards that, you know, don't cost a second mortgage to afford. But based on what we're hearing about the limited stock for the 5080 and the 5090 launch, every single one of these $2,000 GPUs is probably going to sell out instantly, and who knows where the street prices will actually settle. So my question here, is NVIDIA being unreasonable? I don't think so, because they're just doing what any company would do without any meaningful competition. They're competing against themselves, they're trying to make something good enough so that it's worth you upgrading from the last generation. But damn, I really hope that some of the secret sauce here, some of the performance, makes its way down to the regular RTX 50 series cards that everyone can afford. For literally everyone's sake, we need them to not f this up.